Well, good morning. My name is George Cohen. Day three of the annual meeting. What a great meeting it's been, but what our great Army, part of the Joint Force, and you're going to hear from this distinguished panel this morning, really the heart and soul of what the Army's doing. It's part of the Joint Force. I want to welcome you. Thank you for joining us for this contemporary military forum entitled Multi-Domain Operations. As your professional organization, the Association of United States Army's Institute of Land Warfare is proud to provide forums like this one throughout the year that broaden the knowledge base of Army professionals and those who support our Army. This is but one of many ILW contemporary forums this week, as we at AUSA continue to amplify the U.S. Army's narrative to audiences inside the Army and help further the Association's mission to be voice for the Army, support for the soldier. AUSA members help tell the Army story and support our soldiers and their families. A strong membership base is vitally important for our advocacy efforts in Congress, in the Pentagon, and the Defense Industrial Base, as well as to the public in communities across the country through AUSA's 123 chapters. I'd like to take a moment right now. If you're an AUSA member, we would like to recognize you. Please stand if you can, and we'd like to give you a round of applause. Thank you. Now, here's kind of the quid pro quo. For those of you Army professionals who are not yet members of your professional organization, we encourage you to join AUSA. And you can do that very simply by visiting the AUSA membership booth, which is booth 307 in Exhibit Hall A on the floor downstairs. Or you can do it online at AUSA.org/membership. Very easy. So if you're a member, we are so thankful that you're staying with us. And without further ado, I'd like to turn it over to General Pete Palmer, and he'll moderate the panel. So Pete, over to you.
Welcome, everybody. This panel's on multi-domain operations, and as most of you know, that as the Army looks forward to the future, we develop concepts that eventually lead to capabilities that we can field on how we're going to fight and win and do the engagements in the future. So today we're going to be looking at where our next future's going for discussions, and we've got a great panel with that. The panel lead will be General Townsend, TRADA, U.S. Army Training and Doctrine Command. Lieutenant General Wesley, Army Capabilities Integration Center, General Brown, U.S. Pacific Command, Lieutenant General Patrick Sanders from the Commander Field Army, British Army, and also Dr. Michael O'Hanlon, excuse me, Senior Fellow Foreign Policy Studies, Brookings Institute. Sir?
Thanks, Pete. Good morning. I feel like I'm a little bit in the interrogation block of Sears School right now with these Klieg lights shining. If you see us doing this, it's just we're trying to see who the questioner is out there. Today's panel's on multi-domain operations. And before I get started, I'd like to offer a special thanks to General Bob Brown, who's traveled from the Pacific, and he's going to give us some perspective on some real-world multi-domain operations, to Lieutenant General Patrick Sanders, my battle buddy from the U.K., who's traveled here to give us a multinational partner perspective, and Dr. Michael O'Hanlon from the Brookings, who's going to give us some thoughts, a little bit of historical perspective, and maybe a little bit of red teaming here. Our purpose today is to facilitate a discussion of the most current evolution of the Army's new warfighting concept, multi-domain operations. On Monday, the Secretary of the Army in his opening remarks, referred to multi-domain operations as our warfighting concept for the future. That's driving us towards the Army of 2028. Yesterday, the Chief of Staff of the Army also went into greater detail about multi-domain operations in his Eisenhower lunch speech. We also gave a briefing yesterday. That briefing was pretty well attended yesterday afternoon. The intent was to try to lay out some of the details that this panel format doesn't allow us to get into. And so today we'll now facilitate a discussion on multi-domain operations. So how this is will work is we'll first provide a little bit of an overview of the concept that'll be done by Lieutenant General Wesley. Then General Brown will give some real-world briefing, a real-world update on his operational experience with an experimental organization that our Army has called the Multi-Domain Task Force and the work that they've been doing in both experimentation and real operations in the Indo-Pacific theater. Then Lieutenant General Sanders will give a little bit of perspective from an allied partner perspective. And then Dr. O'Hanlon will give us a historical perspective, a little glimpse into the future perhaps, maybe a little of some thoughts on red teaming of our ideas. Then we'll turn it over to Q&A. And there'll be we'll take cards from the audience here, and Pete will tee those up for questions. Okay, I've got a couple of slides. You can show the first slide. Thank you. Okay, so what's new about MDO? We call this MDO 1.5. You know the history of this a little bit. On the left side of the slide is airland battle. On the right side of the slide is this new version of the concept. We published Multi-Domain Operations 1.0 last year. Last spring, the Army senior leaders tasked me right after I assumed command of TRADOC to evolve our warfighting concept, to expand our warfighting concept, to increase the detail, and to operationalize it as soon as possible. Thus, we're unveiling MDO 1.5 this week. We're going to refine the concept in the coming weeks, and we plan to publish MDO 1.5 before the end of the year. We have there's distributed handouts. I see some of them laying on the chairs there. So there's some handouts, advanced summaries, trifolds, et cetera, available here to the audience. Bottom line up front, this concept will drive change to achieve the Army's vision of ready today, more lethal tomorrow. So what's the problem we're trying to solve? Next slide. So, you know, every concept is trying to solve a problem. What's ours? Simply, layered standoff. So I just heard a senior defense official give a speech a few minutes ago, and he referred to we're entering into a new era of great power competition. And that's what this concept seeks to address. Now, there's some different versions of this slide out there. Some are more complex, more detailed. I chose this one because it shows very simply what our near-peer adversaries are up to. They have studied us carefully since the end of the Cold War, and I think they've got two big kind of key ideas. One, that they're going to compete aggressively below the threshold of armed conflict. And number two, they're going to present multiple layers of standoff from the strategic whole of government level down to the tactical level to hold us at arm's length, both in competition and in armed conflict. Now, at the tactical level, we frequently refer to this as anti-axis or area denial capabilities. What our adversaries have done is they've taken that notion of anti-axis area denial and they've expanded it to the strategic and whole of government level, even in competition before armed conflict to hold us off. We're calling that layered standoff. As far as competition goes, this is where they have an advantage. And over us in the West. And we once knew how to compete effectively, short of armed conflict. We competed with our near-peer adversaries during the Cold War and defeated them. I think we've lost some of that game, and we're going to have to find a way to compete as effectively in this new era of great power competition. So what's our answer to this problem? Next slide. So it's multi-domain operations. The U.S. Army will conduct multi-domain operations. We will rapidly and continuously integrate our capabilities across all domains, air, land, sea, space, and cyberspace, to prevail in competition. One of the key components of competition is deterrence. If we fail to deter in competition and we move into armed conflict, we will penetrate and we will disintegrate the enemy's layered standoff. We'll then exploit that freedom of maneuver to win and then force a return to competition on terms favorable to us. In simplest terms, though our potential adversaries can contest us in all domains today and in the future, we're going to integrate them faster. We're going to integrate them better than they can. This is a core competency of the United States and the U.S. military, and we will capitalize on this skill to dominate our enemies in the future. We're going to constantly present multiple dilemmas to our adversaries in all domains at a rate they cannot compete with. Okay, I'll now pass the talking stick to Lieutenant General Eric Wesley, the Director of ARCIC, the Army's Combat Integration Center. That Capabilities Integration Center, that organization will be transitioning from TRADOC to Army Futures Command by the end of the year. He's going to provide you an overview of how we're going to conduct multi-domain operations in the future. Eric.
Thanks, sir. How in 5 minutes? Start time. So let me start by backing up a little bit. And as the guy responsible for publishing a concept, just quickly want to mention the role of a concept. If you're like me before you went to TRADOC, you might not even have thought through what a concept is or what the purpose is. And so I would argue that this is fundamentally important for an Army that's getting ready to change, because what concepts do is they give you the framework of the Army that you want to build. And a good concept, when written correctly, is infeasible. That might seem counterintuitive, but a good concept is infeasible, because if it was feasible, we'd make it doctrine and we'd go execute it. Doctrine is that which we can do with the resources and people that we have. So this describes the Army that we want to build in the future, so it's a reach goal. I think that's important to describe up front. And it worked for us once before when we drafted Airland Battle. It resulted in the Army we know and love today. We think this is probably the most fundamental rewrite of a concept since 1981, when Airline Battle came out. General Townsend said I'd describe how this works. There's a slide up there that shows a comparison. I won't brief that slide right now, but it's a good reference that compares both Airland Battle and multi-domain operations, because we think they're fundamentally different. General Townsend described the problem, and the problem is multiple layers of standoff. And in many ways, the scenario we face is inverted relative to what we knew if you were growing up in Europe, where we had interior lines and we were already there and we faced echelons in great numbers that would attack us. This is different because we're strategically out of position relative to what we knew in Airland Battle. The multiple layers of standoff start domestically with everything from the Russian, Chinese, other involvement in our domestic politics with respect to cyber, social media, etc., and then all the way back into the tactical level. So if you have a standoff problem, the first thing you have to be able to do is penetrate. What we're saying is compete, penetrate, disintegrate, and then exploit and recompete. The competition part is critical because it sets the stage to enable the penetration. So what we say in competition is that we want to do three things. We want to enable our forces to defeat their ability to create dissension or break cohesion amongst the coalition. We want to defeat that effort. The second thing is to deter. And then the third is to enable rapid transition to conflict. We're, in many ways, you could say we're not doing that right now. And the ability to constantly assess the order of battle and be prepared through stimulation of sensors really provides an option I'll talk about in a minute that is distinct from what we have today. So the first thing we have to do is compete, and compete in ways that we're not comfortable with right now, and we can talk more about that later. The second is then penetrate. If they've got standoff, you've got to penetrate the reach that they have. Now, penetration isn't sufficient by itself, because if you penetrate and you don't have the ability to exploit that penetration, like a water balloon, it just recedes itself. So you have to disintegrate, and General Odom said yesterday, that doesn't mean atomize. The dash and disintegrate is important. We want to disintegrate their systems, which allows us to employ strategic and operational maneuver. Once you've disintegrated, then you have to exploit. And the exploitation is really dependent on whatever the strategic objectives are of that campaign. So we won't specify here, but the disintegration effort allows or enables maneuver to accomplish whatever objectives you've sought. And then finally, you got to recompete. You got to set the conditions to sustain outcomes. Last thing I'll say, and I think my time is coming to a close here. What this concept does, we believe, is it provides another option for our senior leadership. In many ways, deterrence as we knew it has been challenged. Deterrence is challenged because of what General Townsend talked about, because they are achieving their operational and strategic objectives left of conflict. So deterrence is relatively, becomes muted because if they're achieving their operational and strategic objectives short of conflict, massive retaliation doesn't really mean anything. So therefore, what this does is it offers a second option because our current options are do nothing or engage in a protracted campaign. If we can transition quickly to create dilemmas for our opponents by virtue of our competition space and our ability to penetrate, disintegrate, and exploit quickly, we can alleviate a protracted conflict.
All right, I believe I'm up, and really a great opportunity to be here. Exciting to see a concept being developed that will lead to new doctrine and key to the future. And I'm even more excited because I'm the guy that gets to put it through its paces out in the Indo-Pacific region. And as was said earlier, you know, show where it is feasible and how we can use it in the future. So General Townsend and General Wesley did a great job covering the concept of multi-domain operations. And the evolutionary process that's occurred, and we're seeing some revolutionary impacts as we apply it against the many challenges in the Indo-Pacific region. You know, every theater and every combatant command will be incorporating multi-domain operations into how they fight. And in the Indo-Pacific, we're seeing it now with the testing of a maneuver formation that has unique multi-domain capabilities. And I'll explain a little more about that. We've had a 18-month U.S. Army Pacific and Indo-Pacific Command, and 18 months into a 36-month pilot program where we're using this unique maneuver formation as a part of multi-domain ops, but it's certainly not all. It's one formation, multi-domain task force, and we're using it in joint multinational exercises, simulations, tabletops, experimentation, really anything and everything we can do to evaluate, assess, and capture critical information to inform that doctrine we're talking about. And we've got to go, I think it's really key, from concept to doctrine faster. As Steve Townsend was talking about, air land battle, it took like 14 years. I wish we had 14 years. We don't. So we've got to do it faster from concept to doctrine. For that reason, as we're going through this, we have the right TRADOC folks out there with us, doctrine writers, lessons learned folks. We have AMC, test and evaluation experts. And we look forward, as Army Futures Command is standing up, they're a key part of it as well, staying closely linked with them. So again, as we're learning something, it can move faster. There's no doubt some of the key lessons we're learning, this has got to be joint and multinational, that we're not going to do anything of any significance alone. So we can do this and our allies and partners can't. And certainly joint integration is a key aspect. And one key concept within multi-domain operations is this multi-domain task force. So it's a critical concept, proving to be a real game changer out there. It's maneuverable, it's tailorable, scalable, lethal, and very effective against the A2 AD threat that Steve Townsend mentioned. It's also very survivable on land, which didn't surprise us, but some others it did surprise them. And this, again, multi-domain task force, a part of multi-domain operations, it's anywhere from about 350 people at the core of the command and control to up to 2,000, depending on what you snap link into it. And it's forward deployed is key, and that core being forward deployed is really critical. I'll talk a little bit more about that. And then in that joint C2, it's got to have Navy, along obviously Army, but Navy, Air Force, Marine, Special Ops have to have that C2, or you've got some real challenges. Additionally, it's got a special new element we call the IQs, intel, cyber, electronic warfare, and space portion. And this is at a higher level, intel, cyber, electronic warfare, and space, farther forward than ever before. That's the core of the multi-domain task force. And then other capabilities are snap-linked in as needed. For example, long-range precision fires. It's hard to imagine a time you wouldn't need those, but there may be a time that you don't. A maneuver element, probably about a battalion size, that's capable of denial and deception, as well as security. And then air defense artillery, an aviation task force, again, may need it sometimes, may not others, and logistics support you're going to need just about all the time. But it might be you can get that from your multinational partners, so you don't need that. So, again, we're saying that can be snap-linked in. So we've proven that the joint C2 command and control and the IQs portion of the MDTF is really a key in the competition phase. It's also key if it moves to conflict. But getting them there early in the competition phase is critical. Enabled you to make key decisions, particularly in cyber and space domains, and posture yourself if things should go worse and head into conflict. Of course, long-range precision fires are the central aspect of the multi-domain task force, and they're key. But also, so is maneuver. Again, it's got to be, it's that far forward, it's got to be able to maneuver. Denial and deception at levels, where we've never seen before. And a little bit different denial and deception, where sometimes you're going to try to hide something. Other times you're going to put so many hundreds of thousands of things out there that you'll confuse the enemy. Where is the real actual thing they're looking for? And they'll waste a lot of time. And then again, survivability being key. So, and I think a key thing, and I stole this from Steve Townsend, I'll give credit where credit's due, is, and he hit it right on the head, that we learned that you've got to go from episodic integration, where you can integrate, but it takes weeks, sometimes months, to continual integration. It really takes minutes and hours. And that's a big difference from where it takes a long time. We can do that, but it takes a long time. We got to make it where it's much more regular and truly integrated. And then some other key lessons just to, all sensors and shooters have to be agnostic. So it doesn't matter whether it's an Air Force, Navy, Marine, special ops platform. You should be able to have a sensor forward that can share with multiple platforms that could affect that target. And that sounds easy. As we all know, it's not. We have that challenge sometimes even within our own service, let alone between services. Convergence that was mentioned, we're finding is critical. The convergence, a concept to enable maneuver in multiple domains to a point of advantage. And you get inside that A2AD umbrella with convergence, and you're moving to a position of relative advantage in multiple domains. Operations must be unpredictable, nonlinear, and present multiple dilemmas simultaneously. We've seen the need for a common joint language, and you see in the slide there, this really gets at, reinforces a little bit, air-land battle, we had close, deep, and rear, and now there's seven in the operational framework for that's been developed for multi-domain operations, and we're using in the Indo-Pacific across the board, all the services bought into this, because it gives you a common language to talk about, otherwise you don't have it. And you can see there's the strategic, operational, and tactical support area, those three. There's the close area, the deep maneuver area, the deep fires area, and an ad from the Air Force, the strategic deep fires area, an excellent ad from them for seven in the operational framework, absolutely key. So let me give you an example of what we did recently. Again, multi-domain operations, but a multi-domain task force portion of that in the Pacific, in the Philippines, in a scenario in the compete phase. They were forward early in the compete phase. So they were able to establish, find some weaknesses in the adversary systems, particularly, again, in cyber and space, not only in cyber and space, but find those weaknesses forward, competing every day, not periodically, but there forward, every single day, competing and shaping and working in that compete phase that Eric mentioned. And then if conflict occurs, when conflict in this scenario, in this example, the maneuver assets were able to penetrate on land as long-range precision fires, again, from an island, engage and effectively engage adversary air defense assets on land at a range around 499 kilometers that was used, defeating a portion of their A2AD, not all of it, but a portion of the A2AD umbrella. Long-range sensor feedback was provided by a terrific platform, the F-35. So in a little different role, long-range sensor feedback, the F-35, perfect for that. Enemy didn't even know it was there. And while a cyber operation is occurring to open a window for special forces assets at sea, It also enabled maneuver to disintegrate, as was mentioned earlier, disintegrate the enemy mid-range fires with armed UAVs forward, presenting multiple dilemmas to the enemy. So this was just one scenario in the Philippines as we used them. They were also able to exploit, as denial and deception operations confused the adversary of the and caused them to expend a lot of extensive ISR and munitions in the wrong area. Meanwhile, the multi-domain task force was able to maneuver on land, a key aspect again, maneuver to another position, and continue to exploit the seams. So the result is the application of convergence, that was mentioned earlier, to really get after that A2AD umbrella, present multiple dilemmas to the enemy, open up windows for friendly maneuver and continued options. I think the chief said it great yesterday, General Milley, a perfect harmony of intense violence is what I just described there in that example, perfect harmony of intense violence. So that was one example, and again, we're continuing in tabletops, joint multinational exercises, and it certainly is going to apply in all theaters. This was an example in the Pacific, but put it in the plains of Europe, and same capability that you'll have. A maneuver element that integrates and converges joint capabilities and maneuvers to a position of relative advantage in all domains. And another, I thought it was brilliant of the chief yesterday, again, the description, the best way to summarize the lessons, what we're learning, a shift from battles of attrition to battles of cognition. From attrition to cognition, and, you know, leveraging that joint integration. And finally, you know, I think as we move from concept to doctrine faster, the most important aspect in this and the key lesson is that it's our people who will make us successful in this. You have to have that investment in people. Fortunately, our mission command style that we switched to in 2008 that enables empowerment, because there's going to be times you're going to be degraded mode forward, and you have to have that initiative, empowered individuals, people will be the key to our success. That's probably the most important lesson as we're going through this. I look forward to your questions. Thanks.
Thanks, sir. Just as a reminder for everybody, if you have questions, to fill out the 3x5 cards and pass those. We'll have somebody collecting them so we can get those organized to do the Q&A session. Thanks, sir. General Sanders?
If you need a card, hold up your hand. Someone will bring one around.
Yeah.
So thank you. It's a great honor to be on such a distinguished panel and amongst some old friends as well. On Sunday, the 4th of March, 2018, Sergei Skripal and his daughter Yulia were poisoned in Salisbury, my hometown. My wife and I have sat on the park bench where the Skripals collapsed and eaten at the same table they occupied in Zizi's restaurant. From CCTV recordings, we know that shortly before he collapsed, Sergei Skripal handed some bread with his heavily contaminated hands, the stuff is like wet paint, to a group of 8-year-old boys feeding ducks. One of those boys ate the bread. As we all now know, the subsequent investigation confirmed that they were poisoned by a Novichok nerve agent planted by two GRU agents, Yevgeny Mishkin and Anatoly Chapiga. This was a state-sponsored attempt to murder the Skripals using a banned weapon in breach of the Chemical Weapons Convention and international law. It led to the death of Dawn Sturgis, who found the discarded perfume bottle containing the Novichok. Salisbury serves as a cautionary tale when we consider multi-domain operations. Across the world, revisionist powers and rogue regimes are competing across all domains and dimensions to further their power and influence. They have increased efforts short of armed conflict by expanding coercion to new fronts, blurring the distinction between home and away, and exploiting the gray zone between peace and war. Salisbury falls neatly into this description. It's more than competition, but it's short of war. It's an attack on home soil and acting in the physical and the virtual domains to achieve an effect in the cognitive dimension. The publicity, the humiliation of the GRU, these things suit Putin. They amplify what he's trying to achieve. So much of our focus has, of course, been on the physical domains of MDO, but we neglect the significance of the virtual and the cognitive dimensions at our peril when we consider how to build the tools for MDO. Ukraine, the Arab Spring alone, illustrate that maneuver in the virtual and cognitive dimensions serve as an accelerant, an enabler for the physical. So I think that our actions in the virtual and cognitive dimensions are as important to our ability to compete, penetrate, disrupt, or disintegrate, and exploit as they are in the physical. So what can allies bring to MDO, and what do we need? Well, let me start with what we need, and that's interoperability. Multi-domain task forces have to be interoperable. It is hard enough, as we've heard, to make it joint, let alone making it interoperable with allies and partners. So our approach initially, anyway, should be to focus ruthlessly on only the essential partners, either those who are indispensable by virtue of geography, or those who can keep up, or at least contribute niche capabilities in one or more domains. Now, I'm not going to dwell on interoperability. The slide's the right one. As it's being covered in another panel session, but I'll just make three points. First of all, the really significant progress that we've made in UK-US interoperability against this bilateral vision statement has been down to the quality of three people, three US DCGs, Mike Tarser originally, then Doug Christman, and now Matt Van Wagenen. Secondly, Warfighter and JWA are the drivers, and in future, I hope, participation in multi-domain task force exercises and experimentation. And thirdly, I think we now need to make explicit in a revised bilateral vision statement how the UK and possibly other allies will contribute to a US-led multi-domain task force as a matter of urgency. So what role can allies contribute? What can we play in MDO? Well, there are the obvious things. So access, basing and overflight, insight, influence, burden sharing, and some legitimacy. And of course, the Five Eyes relationship delivers trust a much greater mutual understanding, and that generates, crucially, it generates tempo. And allies bring some hard-edged capabilities in the physical domains. So in our case, this will now include a new generation of frigates, aircraft carriers, submarines, and F-35Bs, as well as on land, our strike brigades, in addition to our existing airborne and armored formations, and some pretty respectable special forces. But self-evidently, the problem set that MDO needs to counter needs more than a physical domain response. And here I think the UK can bring several other capabilities that can make a contribution to any future multi-domain task force. So until recently, we've been overly focused on activity in the physical dimension, the traditional area of strength for any armed force. We're now seeking to ensure that we are as strong in the virtual as we are in the physical. This is not a case of substituting physical for virtual capabilities. Instead, we need to ensure that we're proficient in both to be genuinely competitive. And that allows you to have a decisive effect in the cognitive dimension. In the British Army, we're working to achieve this within the context of a cross-governmental fusion doctrine, which seeks to harness the levers of national power to achieve unified effect. And we're developing what we understand by land maneuver, usually, of course, delivered as part of a wider joint campaign. So land maneuver traditionally comprises ground and air maneuver. But we've broadened this to include information maneuver. And cumulatively, this gives us the ability to persistently compete and deter in that grey zone between peace and war. And if fighting commences, it allows us to defeat our enemies through the integrated application of land manoeuvre. Information manoeuvre plays a vital role within this. It synchronises the Army's intelligence networks, cyber, influence and security capabilities to ensure that the sum of the whole is greater than the parts. Just as importantly, it docks us into the wider joint cross-governmental and allied enterprises, and our national ability to exploit strategic national assets is almost unparalleled. It's one of the virtues of being small. We've also placed a big bet on this capability, converting one of our divisions to a formation that is dedicated to information maneuver, forming a new brigade to focus on non-kinetic effects, harnessing the latent talent of our nation, recruiting the best and the brightest innovators in the UK into this formation as reservists, often unpaid, and bringing together all of the information-centric capabilities to achieve the synergies we need. It is exciting, and as General Steve will tell you, it's already delivering on operations. We have established a Land Information Manoeuvre Operations Centre, which will support Army operations across the globe, and on the battlefield, information manoeuvre groups work with Army and Joint Fires capabilities to compete, penetrate, disrupt and exploit. We're finding the establishment of these multidisciplinary teams are making a decisive contribution to our multi-domain capability. They enhance combined arms manoeuvre, converge cross-domain capabilities, support operations at echelon, and crucially exploit human potential. As part of a wider coalition, information manoeuvre offers a force multiplier, which harnesses digital capabilities to ensure we can achieve what some have referred to as cognitive manoeuvre through a combination of both virtual and physical effects. So I think we recognise the same challenges. I think we're trying to work alongside you to develop solutions. True interoperability is beginning to underpin this work, and we will seek to keep up and stay in step with you. I hope you'll find any British contribution to a future multi-domain task force to be valuable. Thank you.
Thank you for the privilege of being here, and I can see it's a great conference this week. I got to say hello to General Milley on the way in. I congratulated him for the Red Sox victory last night at about 11:30 over the New York Yankees, and he said, I didn't see it because I had to go to bed so I'd be fresh for this morning and the third day of the conference, which I never, ever thought I would hear General Milley say about any Boston sports team. So congratulations to the intellectual vibrancy and the important work that's being done here and discussed this week at the conference. I want to briefly play the role that General Townsend mentioned. I would try to play of a little bit of historical perspective and a little bit of red teaming. I like what I'm hearing about multi-domain operations, but I would voice a couple of caveats or at least points to bear in mind from history as we've thought about previous big ideas in military innovation and learned how some of them have worked better than others. I'm going to go fast to try to stay within my time, so I'm going to oversimplify. So with apologies to those concepts that I'm about to trash a little bit, I know that some of them actually did achieve good things and a lot of good people worked on them, and they were generally all well-intentioned, but I think in the grand scheme of big ideas, big phrases in modern military history, not everything has reached the summit of air-land battle in terms of effectiveness, in terms of demonstrated contribution to the joint fight, and therefore I want to voice some reminders of how these sorts of ideas can go a little astray if we're not careful. So I'm going to be quick, as I say, but let me go back to Force 21, which was on, I think, General Townsend's first slide, and also the way in which that related to the concepts of the 1990s that the Army talked about with the Army After Next, and ultimately the future combat system. I don't want to dwell on this, just like I don't want to dwell for Yankees fans on last night's near victory. but I do feel that on balance, while there were a lot of good ideas associated with Army innovation and forward thinking in the 1990s, the future combat system was the physical manifestation of that dream, and it ultimately more or less failed. And it's worth bearing in mind, I think, that lesson, and the main reason I would say that the future combat system didn't really succeed is because the technology wasn't ripe for the kinds of ideas and visions that were being promulgated. Again, I'm oversimplifying. We can come back to that in discussion if you wish. But one way in which concepts can go awry is if they are disconnected from technological reality and what's really doable physically. It's one thing to have the idea of what you want to do. It's something else to be able to do it. If we now get away a little bit broader, go away from the Army alone, and think about two other ideas that were popular in about this same late 1990s or early 2000s time period, net-centric warfare and full-spectrum dominance. These were, in the first instance, largely a Navy concept from Admiral Sabrowski, a man who I had great admiration for and was privileged to be on a couple of panels with back in the day. And then the full-spectrum dominance was much more of a joint vision, which also went along with Joint Vision 2010, 2020, 2030, 2035. We heard about those. That was a sort of a period of time when there was always a new iteration every couple of years. And I think, for the most part, these concepts also were relatively unsuccessful. And the reason I would say they were not that, you know, notable for their lasting contribution, they were too big and broad and vague. They were kitchen sink ideas. Now, net-centric warfare was a little more specific, but the problem was on, again, technology, that Admiral Sabrowski and others recognized we were at a crucial moment in cyber capability, but unfortunately, a lot of the things we were doing in the cyber realm were actually making the problems worse, not better, largely by taking off-the-shelf software and putting it on all sorts of weapons and command and control systems, which now have resulted in unreliability for these systems, especially in the face of great power threats, countries that are capable of getting into these systems and making them fail. So again, bear in mind, if you're not matched up well with the technology, you can get in trouble, and also if you try to do too much, if you try to make these concepts so inclusive that everybody gets to play because you're trying to be a good morale builder for the joint force and you wind up saying things like full spectrum dominance. Of course, who could be against full spectrum dominance? It's like being against apple pie, except that, you know, the Yankees and the Red Sox both couldn't win. Not every technology is equally ripe. There are moments in history where certain things are more doable than others. And if you use a phrase that's completely ecumenical and inclusive, you're probably resorting to a least common denominator kind of thinking that's not going to help you very much. Let me try to keep speeding up. Army operating concept. I liked the Army operating concept of a few years ago, H.R. McMaster, General Perkins, others. But the reason I liked it personally was that I felt it was pushing back usefully against some, in a very subtle way, but still an important way, against some of the new emerging conventional wisdom in Washington and with the Obama administration, which is we're not going to do these messy conflicts anymore. We're just going to focus future fights on the kinds of wars we like to fight. We're going to get away from COIN and counterterrorism and stabilization missions. This was sort of the moment, 2012, 2013, 2014, when the Defense Strategic Guidance and the QDR tended to say all these things. The Army was not going to maintain a large force structure capable of large-scale stabilization any longer. I thought much of that civilian guidance was wishful thinking. And it's the sort of thing we engage in the United States every time we come out of a messy set of conflicts. We decide we're never going to do that again, which is sort of the most dangerous sort of strategic thought you can have, that you get to choose which wars you will fight. To some extent, we should try to choose. To some extent, we don't get to choose. And therefore, I thought Army operating concept pushed back by reminding people that today's soldier needed to be ready for many different kinds of scenarios, not just the ones that the civilian leadership or strategic community might prefer to see us focus on going forward. I'm going to finish up now quickly with two others of more recent vintage, Air-Sea Battle, and then its successor. And how many people remember the name of the successor, the Joint Concept for Access and Maneuver in the Global Commons. I hope I've been somewhat critical of that concept already just by naming the name, because clearly, as much as it was trying to do some good things and probably has, Air-Sea Battle began as a little too much of an echo of Air-Land Battle. It wasn't clear, by the way, where the Army and the Marine Corps and the Allies fit into Air-Sea Battle. It sounded a little bit too anti-China for the time we were in, and the Chinese knew it was against them, and we all said it wasn't against them, and no one believed anything they were saying, really, because we all knew we needed to get better at Pacific operations, long-range operations. But Air-Sea Battle seemed a little too parochial, a little too narrow, and a lot of people that I talked to in the Army and Marine Corps thought it was a play by the Air Force and Navy for more budget share, more than it was anything else. Now, that may be more of a problem and how it was unfurled and discussed. It may not be inherent to the concept, but again, as Air-Sea Battle transitioned to Joint Concept for Access and Maneuver in the Global Commons, it sort of revealed itself to be a little too big, a little too vague. Again, watch out for big, vague ideas. So in conclusion now, let me say one or two words very fast on what this makes me think, this historical perspective about multi-domain operations. There are some good things, there are some cautionary notes. I'm just going to tick them off and we can discuss more later if you like. Good things, there's a lot of focus on cyber and other command and control vulnerabilities. And General Wesley talked to me about this when I visited him at Fort Benning last winter. It was very much his focus there. I know the Army's been pushing this sort of thinking. We have built up command and control expectations and systems that are probably not going to survive in the face of a determined peer adversary. And obviously, the wars of the 21st century have probably made this problem worse because of the nature of the enemies we had in Iraq, Afghanistan, and the broader CENTCOM theater. They were not capable of threatening our space, cyber, et cetera. And so we got a little bit too accustomed to owning this space without contestation. So I like the fact that multi-domain operations constantly talks about vulnerabilities. It also talks about anti-access area denial and keeps that concept central in our thinking, namely how enemies can prevent us from approaching their territory. That's useful as well. And it does focus on great power competition, which therefore backs up the national security strategy, the national defense strategy. Again, that's all to the good. If I have concerns, they're not meant to be harsh criticisms, but they are concerns. Some of the slides, some of the language is still very broad. It makes it seem sometimes like we're trying to do everything, be all things to all people. So sometimes there's an emphasis on repairing vulnerability, but then there's an emphasis on long-range strike with admiration for General Brown's framework. But still, if I could use the seven different zones, it's both a reflection of the reality of the modern battlefield, but it's also a lot to remember and a lot to focus on simultaneously. Are we thinking primarily about offensive fires or defensive resilience? Are we thinking primarily about new technologies like directed energy and hypersonic weapons, or are we thinking about short-range air defense and longer-range artillery? You see where I'm coming from. I don't know what the emphasis is sometimes because the words are so big and broad that it's slightly evocative of full-spectrum dominance and concepts like that from an earlier day that I don't think left a big legacy. So my and one last point is that because of this breadth, I wasn't sure in all the presentations that I've heard so far and the literature that I've seen. I wasn't sure if there are certain technology emphases or if it's really just trying to reiterate what happens to be in the existing acquisition program writ large. So those are concerns. They're not meant to be hard-hitting, lethal blows. And I think some of them can be addressed by the panelists here to the extent they wish to. So why don't I stop there and look forward to the discussion. Thank you.
Thank the panel. And now we'll transition to question and answers. And again, I request that if you have it, hold up your card so you can pass them to the center, and we'll get them up here to be able to answer them. Let me start out with the first question. General Townsend, General Wesley, how do you see the relationships of concepts to doctrine between Army's Future Command and TRADOC?
Okay, I'll take that and pass it to General Wesley. So first of all, General Wesley laid out what's the definition, the difference between doctrine and concepts. Doctrine, of course, being how we fight the Army we have today, and concepts are how we think we're going to fight our Army of the future. It's also designed to draw our Army there, not just doctrinally, conceptually and doctrinally, but also physically, right? To drive the systems that we will need to employ that doctrine in the future, and the training of the leaders and the soldiers and all of that. So this concept is, as Eric said, pretty infeasible today to do it to the degree we have to do it. Do we do multi-domain operations today? Absolutely we do. And as General Brown suggested, I've been quoted before, today we would do what I would call episodic synchronization of the domains. And synchronization was sort of our key watchword for airland battle that got us through to today. We've been able to out-synchronize the warfighting functions, out-synchronize our enemies. That's no longer going to be good enough in the future. We're going to have to rapidly and continuously integrate all the domains of warfare in the future to be successful against our near-peer adversaries. That's a challenge for us to do today on a lot of levels, which I won't go into now. So one last thought on this. As I mentioned, that ARCIC will transition to Army Futures Command before the end of the year as we stand that organization up and get it running. The development of future concepts and the next evolution of multi-domain operations that I hope will address some of Dr. O'Hanlon's criticisms or cautionary thoughts there. I think that that will be a task to Army Futures Command. It will go with ARCIC, but they are going to be the continuity in the concept as they carry it to Army Futures Command. And TRADOC will focus on turning these future concepts into operational doctrine that we can fight with today. Eric, your thoughts?
Sure. A couple things. First, if I were to answer the question in short, the doctrine is developed commensurate with our capacity to execute the concept as drafted. So it's important that General Lundy's team stays welded at the hip with ARCIC, because they can publish the doctrine as we field capabilities, train soldiers to the degree they can execute this concept. But I would direct your attention to the slide that's there. It's a bigger question that I think is important as it relates to what Army Futures Command will do to bring multi-domain operations to fruition by 2028, which is what the Secretary has charged us to do. And so what you see there on the right, it's sort of a busy chart. I'll just walk you through it. On the right, what that shows is a series of palm years that gets you to 2028. And by the way, there's not too many between now and then, right? And so everything in the building, if anybody's worked in the building, knows that every question that's ever asked in the building all goes back to either a budget or POM issue, because every decision is a trade somewhere. But you need a metric to make those trades. How do you balance what you will buy, won't buy, what you divest, what you invest in? And so you really got to go all the way to the left side of the chart. And it starts with a pacing threat. And I'd note that this is the first time in probably 25 years that we have formally used a pacing threat to develop concepts. So we've got a pacing threat. We did the Russian New Generation Warfare Study. We've got a good read on what we think our opponents are doing. And we also have the NDS that gives us guidance as to how the Army should fight. And then you develop a concept. And the concept reconciles the problem that the pacing threat poses to you. And that's what we're talking about today. But you can't stop with just the concept. Once you publish the concept, you need a strategy to get to 2028 or whatever your destination period is. And so in parallel with this concept, we've been building Army Modernization Strategy 1.5, and that'll come out at the winter AUSA, stay tuned. And the key thing about this strategy is it will be .MIL-PF wide. So it will have chapters based on each initial and in that lovely acronym that we have that will give, essentially, it'll be a guidance document across the enterprise. So what is the role of Army Futures Command as we evolve this concept? It will be to husband or steward that modernization strategy, which touches the entire modernization enterprise, in many cases, beyond AFC itself. Thank you.
General Brown, how will you train for multi-domain operations? Will the synthetic training environment provide all the domains of the competition, i.e. information, cyber, non-kinetic effects?
Well, I'm glad the synthetic training environment was mentioned, because I do think that is really a key across the board and something we've It's an example of, as Michael was saying, we thought of, 8-10 years ago, how do we get where squads can train? I mean, if you look back about 70 years, we hadn't changed how we're training squads, yet the world has gotten so much more complex. But the technology wasn't there yet. We couldn't do it. We had to put big, bulky systems on them, brick-mortar facilities, and it was very expensive, and we still couldn't get the realism. Well, there's some real breakthroughs now. Thanks, augmented reality and really the gaming world, and where the outside industry is leading, and we're pulling it into defense. So the synthetic training environment is the future of how you're going to train a lot of the complexities we talked about here, because it is a very complex environment. You know, you can't just disregard cyber. You can't disregard space. Hey, that doesn't apply to us. So many aspects we never had to worry about before. I mean, if you just go to a combat training center, I thought it was tough when I went through multiple times, and boy, I wouldn't want to go through now because they've added a lot of that complexity. So that training, that synthetic training environment will enable us to up the game initially with the squad, where they'll be able to, it's much like, you know, if you use an example of a fighter pilot that can practice, or a helicopter pilot can practice thousands and thousands of scenarios in a simulator incredibly realistically. And I've witnessed in combat where that saved their life. When something happens, it can only practice in a simulator, and then they land safely and save lives because of that tremendous effort we put into those simulations. Well, now we're going to have that for the squad and for those folks where, as General Milley pointed out, 80% of the casualties occur the pointy end of the spear, and we're going to have that. And it's got to incorporate these complexities we've been discussing here, and it will. They'll be able to be in different scenarios, from desert, jungle, and most importantly, I believe, urban. Urban is the future, and right now that's very tough. Great mount sites, but you can't get a mega city type. You know, we've looked at, could we build it? How do you do it? Well, you're going to have to use simulation and combined with the actual site. So I think it is, I'm glad someone pointed out, it is absolutely essential. It will train starting at the squad, and then I see it as we look, the next revolution is in home station training to get to that complexity. We can do it at the CTCs now, but how do we then go from the squad where we're getting it in the synthetic training environment to the platoon, the company, the brigade, who will all eventually become multi-domain capable, or they'll be irrelevant now, you know, whether that's 2 years, 5 years, 10 years from now. But they've got to move that way, and so that training and synthetic training environment has to expand beyond for home station training. So that's my portion of it.
If I can just throw something in there.
Sure.
So this goes back to the .MIL-PF question, and a lot of times we think modernization, we continually think about the material implications of it. But so we're talking about training right here, and so this modernization strategy that we published, we'll talk a lot about training. It did an air land battle too. One of the reasons we developed the CTCs was because the installations we had that many times developed in the last century were too small to fight an air land battle type construct. So it impacts training. In this case, it is going to be the STE environment. And here's the reason why I think it is a difficult concept to execute. It's going to be a very rapid, hyperactive battlefield that's exceedingly lethal. So getting reps and sets into the hands at all echelons on how to fight this will be fundamental. You know, we talk about, you know, take a great quarterback like Peyton Manning, Tom Brady. They take thousands and thousands of snaps from the line before they get really good. A major today who is going to do his KD time in a brigade might get one rep at the National Training Center. And this is a lot harder than playing football. So we've got to, we will develop, or we've got to come to grips with a complete paradigm shift that probably harkens back to 25-100-101, where we change our training paradigm in a way that gets a lot of reps and sets into the hands of soldiers at Echelon.
May not be many in here, remember, battalion training management system and the plastic cards, 8-step training model. Well, I think there's a modern version of that. That'll all be on apps and stuff now, but that definitely is a modern version of that. Great point.
General Sanders and General Townsend, we anticipate the use of unconventional warfare by our near-peer competitors outside the high-intensity battle. There will likely be irregular warfare augmented by the use of partisan resistance forces by, with, and through U.S. and allied special forces operations. Please describe your thoughts on the offensive use of unconventional warfare in the application of MDO scenarios.
I'll take a quick stab at it and then hand it off to General Patrick. You heard, you know, we have seen real-world examples of the use of unconventional warfare in today, competing in competition short of armed conflict. Little Green Men in Crimea and the Ukraine are great examples of that. By the way, before I forget to say it, let me thank General Patrick for that really powerful and very real example of competition pushing the very limits of short of armed conflict from Salisbury. But this is another example of, you know, using unconventional warfare, Little Green Men running around, accomplishing their strategic objectives short of armed conflict. So I think I said earlier that we used to know how to compete with our near-peer adversaries, and I think we've just kind of gotten rusty there. That skill has atrophied a little bit, and we're going to have to pick up our not only our military competition game, but our whole of government competition game. And General Wesley mentioned the importance of that, especially in competition. The whole of government, the diplomatic, the informational, the economic competition becomes prime, I think. But there's going to be a military competition there short of armed conflict. And it's a recognition that we're not really at peace. And that sort of goes against our U.S. culture a little bit. We're in peace and then we transition to war. What our national security strategy and our national defense strategy recognizes this period of competition. And so I think unconventional warfare is going to be certainly a part of that. I'm not sure about the offensive use of unconventional warfare, but just unconventional warfare in general will certainly be part of that. General Patrick, your thoughts on that?
Thanks, General. And we've got some history sometimes quite helpful. We ran an empire effectively this way, and we're not the only ones to have done it. The notion of proxy maneuver as a subset of land maneuver is kind of what we're getting at here. Now, some of this is because it's politically convenient. So when you have a generation of politicians and commentators, as we do in the UK, who are a bit scarred by experiences, interventions in Iraq and Afghanistan, then they're much more comfortable with using proxies as a means of delivering national interests. And so the creation of what we're calling specialized infantry, what you have created, caused SFABs, both born at about the same time, kind of gets at this. It's designed to build capacity in difficult places, but also to go beyond that into accompanying and enabling proxies to operate. And this is a flank that I think that we can and must exploit in any multi-domain operation, because you're sowing uncertainty, you're operating right the way through the enemy's depth, and you're also doing it at multiple levels of war, because we all know how much strategic compression when it comes to these sort of operations. If you want some examples from history where we've done this, then the Firqa in Oman was a not broadly publicized, but very effective use of proxies. But I think we also, and you could say the same thing about Ukraine now, but we shouldn't be naive because our enemies are going to be doing this to us and arguably already are in some parts of this era of persistent competition that we're involved in at the moment. And sometimes it's not helpful to think of these things and label them as insurgencies and counterinsurgencies. They're part of a broader strategic competition. I can see the chief of the Swedish Defence Forces nodding. If you want some practical experiences of how they're experiencing competition from a Soviet perspective, just speak to him. Russian, sorry.
Thank you, sir. Mr. O'Hanlon, you mentioned that selected joint Army operational strategic concepts are disconnected from technology reality. How would you prioritize joint concepts to achieve a realistic future outcome?
First, I don't want to come on quite that strong. I'm not suggesting they're disconnected. I'm suggesting that when you have a big, broad, ambitious concept that goes across many geographic domains, many services, allies, many types of problems, that the risk is inherently going to be that you lose your focus and that you start overpromising. And the most dangerous result can be that you actually start believing that you've got options in war that you really don't. Because you've been telling yourself you're following this new big idea long enough that you start to believe your own rhetoric. I'm not suggesting that's what's going on now. That's the danger, however, with any big idea. The other danger is you lose your acquisition and your training focus, and you try to do everything instead of doing those things that are really feasible in a new way at a given moment in time. So obviously we could have a whole discussion on different realms of technology, but it strikes me that probably the number one vulnerability we'll have a hard time addressing is going to be the ability to move large forces close to an enemy's territory, the physical vulnerability. The other big vulnerability is in the resilience of our command and control systems against cyber and anti-satellite and anti-sea cable attack and those sorts of things, not to mention electronic warfare at the more tactical and operational level. So I think prioritizing any mitigation of those two problems or vulnerabilities, it has to be near the top of the agenda. But of the two, command and control and the inherent vulnerability of moving big forces near enemy territory, I'm not persuaded that they're both equally solvable. I think we probably can make a lot of headway in making CQDI more resilient. I'm not convinced it's going to be feasible to really approach China or Russia with forces in the hundreds of thousands of total troops at a place where they know we're coming. And so if it's a specific fight in a specific place, direct defense or direct liberation of a piece of seized Allied territory, I think is inherently becoming more difficult just due to trends in technology, and multi-domain operations may or may not be able to change that fact very much. So again, we got to bear in mind what's really feasible, not just what would we like to do.
Thank you. General Brown, accepting the reality of Indo-Pacific operational environment, which is currently characterized by robust AAAD actions by peer competitor China, from political to submarines, long-range precision fires, and forces deployed island-based, are we able to fight tonight?
Well, an easy question. It's about time, you know. Holy smokes. One thing I'm really proud of is just a lot of focus work. You know, the last couple of years has been just a little bit of focus on North Korea. And I was saying at the Indo-Pacific breakfast this morning, what difference a year makes. If last year I would have said that, there'd be a summit between, President Trump and Kim Jong-un, they'd probably drag me off the stage and have my head examined and hear, those things happen. You can't predict it. But one thing that's happened with that laser focus from the challenges from North Korea over the last 2 years is an incredible effort to have a all things Pacific and tremendous support from joint, certainly Army, and then in theater, a laser focus from Indo-PACOM as well that has been incredibly beneficial. And so I feel very, as responsible for the Army forces, 85,000 plus that would in the theater assigned already, I feel very confident they are ready to fight tonight and more, a better readiness at higher levels than ever. Now looking, and again, we all want diplomatic effort is the lead, and no one wants to fight. You have to be crazy to want to fight, but at the same time, our nation asks us to be ready. So I feel very confident we're ready, and in our set the theater role, we're as ready as we've ever been. And prepared, and in things like little operations, like we have non-combatant evacuation operations that U.S. Army Pacific has for the whole theater, and if we should have to execute it, you know, even in Korea, we've come a long way, tremendous efforts, and we are more ready than we've ever been, and would be complex, but we could do it. So I feel very confident in that. Now, getting to a little bit more to the future, talking, you know, if we want to pull in China and fight tonight, I think. You know, we have got some. We've had a period of a strategic atrophy, where, as you know, the Secretary of Defense said, where others have built, and we have some work to do. And the good news is, this concept gets us right down that path, and it ties in perfectly, absolutely perfectly, with the six Army modernization priorities. I mean, they fit this. It's not like these are disconnected. They fit perfectly. Number one is long-range precision fires, which I was just talking about, the key aspect we're finding in multi-domain operations in the multi-domain task force, those long-range precision fires. Got to be able to get back where we can outgun, and being the senior mentor for long-range precision fires and the cross-functional team, another tremendous thing we have done, created these cross-functional teams, because in my 6 years in TRADOC, the hardest thing I had to deal with, Combined Arms Center and Maneuver Center, was trying to pull all these folks together to move in the same direction, PMs, acquisition, keep .mil PF going. Well, now you have that pulled together into cross-functional teams and the establishment of Army Futures Command. Fantastic. You know, I know we're putting a lot of pressure on them. They haven't done anything yet, but I'm positive. Mike Murray and Army Futures Command, it's the right way to go to be able to cut through a lot of the stuff that has caused this problems in the past, and synchronize us and help us with .mil PF to get where we need to go, so we can fight tonight against a near peer and anybody. Can we do it now? Of course. But can we do it better if we get after multi-domain operations and work again the acquisition process and all those aspects and the modernization priorities? Absolutely. That's what we need, and we're heading in the right direction.
Thank you, sir. General Townsend, General Wesley, the Army modernization priorities appeared to focus heavily on technology. Although that will help us address the changing character of warfare, it appears to not focus as much on the nature of warfare and its impact on the human dimension. How does each priority integrate with the human dimension?
I'll take a first crack at that. I think I would disagree that they focus on technology. All of these, there are actually eight cross-functional teams that support our six modernization priorities. And of those eight cross-functional teams, two of them, I think, are directly related. All of them are related to the human dimension in one way or the other. Two of them are, you can see, direct ties. I'll focus on those two. First is the synthetic training environment that one question's already been asked about and General Brown has answered. The synthetic training environment is designed to immerse the soldier and the unit in the multi-domain fight of the future and the environment of the future. So, for example, the Chief of Staff of the Army has talked about foreseeing future combat in dense urban terrain mega cities. It's not feasible for us to build mega cities to train in. No matter how large we build our urban combat training centers, they're not going to be mega cities. So we're going to have a mix, a better mix in the future of live training in those urban facilities and synthetic training. So we're working on that with the synthetic training environment cross-functional team. We are working on embedding the soldier in the synthetic training environment. And he can go, so the chief has described a typical day for an infantry platoon. They wake up, they do PT. The chief envisions us doing 3 hours of PT. I don't envision myself doing 3 hours of PT. but we do a lot of PT, and then we go to chow, and then we strap on our gear. It's not training gear. It's not miles. It's our warfighting kit. And our warfighting kit has embedded connections to training. So you put on your warfighting kit, you put on your heads-up display, which gives you a day vision capability, a night vision capability, and it gives you the situational awareness capability provided by our, for example, Blue Force Tracker kind of things today. So you put that on, and the platoon leader, the company commander, selects any city in the world, Bangkok, Moscow, Baghdad, Mosul, you name it, wherever the unit leader wants to fight that day, and can put a realistic enemy threat laydown in that city, and right in the unit area, those soldiers train until lunch. They stop, they have lunch, they put on their kit again in the afternoon, and they do another battle or two. And you've heard the Secretary of Defense say that he wants every soldier and Marine to have fought 25 battles in training before they fight their first one in real life. So that's very directed, focused on the human dimension of warfare. And I'd tell you that also, something I think is remarkable here, a good linkage between the Secretary of Defense and the Army is the Secretary of Defense has this close combat task force. The Army has the soldier lethality cross-functional team. They are very well connected and nested. So for the first time in my 36-plus years in uniform, the soldier and the small unit, squad and platoon, have the same modernization priority that the next ship, the next bomber, the next helicopter or tank or rocket have. And what I have seen over the course of my career is all of our money go to those big high-end systems, and we don't spend on the soldier, and someone's already at this table has mentioned, 90% of our casualties in combat historically come from the ground component and the infantry. So, and the small teams of engineers and fire supporters that support them. So, this soldier lethality and close combat task force, soldier lethality, CFT, are directly focused, I think, on the human dimension of war.
So, General Palmer, I'm going to take the override and yes, address sir. The question a little bit, because General Townsend hit that one thoroughly. I agree with everything that General Townsend shared. But the other way to ask the question is, what are the what aspects of the human dimension are critical to multi-domain operations? And if you look, if you've got this roadmap that we've built within multi-domain operations, about halfway down, it talks about the tenets of multi-domain operations. On the right side, there underneath convergence, we talk about mission command and discipline initiative. When we were drafting the concept, I will tell you, we had thoughts of picking different words. My biggest concern when you read mission command is a fundamental human domain factor in executing multi-domain operations is that our eyes will glaze over and we'll go on to the next sentence. Because we talk about mission command all the time, and we've got great doctrine in mission command. Our concern is that we don't execute the way our doctrine speaks. We don't execute mission command to the degree we should, and more importantly, to the degree we will need to in this environment. We think that you will have to see mission command on a scale that our generation has never seen. And why is that? Because if we're contested in all domains and we are distributed like we must, as Ukrainians will tell you you've got to be, you're going to find opportunities in a hyperactive environment that you've got to seize. And if you don't, you'll fail. If you do, you will dominate. So we've got to embrace this idea of mission command in our training environment that empowers in ways that we are not comfortable with.
Okay, thank you. Mr. O'Hanlon, how could MDO fall flat? How could it lead us astray if we make mistakes?
Thanks for the opportunity to sort of drill down on a couple other points I'd already alluded to, but for emphasis, let me just add one or two more dimensions to my earlier concern. First of all, I think that if, in terms of how it could fall flat by trying to do too much. And then you start to get to a world in which there isn't sufficient clarity. And then let's say there's a realignment politically in Washington in the next couple of months, the defense budget plateaus or comes down a little. I don't think it's going to come down a lot, but it could plateau. Then the Army has to start to prioritize not just within modernization, but also modernization versus new readiness and force structure initiatives. And I appreciated Secretary Esper's comments from Monday and the Chief's comments, in which there is an effort now to streamline and to look for areas of waste or lower priority. But I also see the Army trying to do a big modernization agenda, an improvement in readiness that some have described as in a crisis state. I'm not persuaded that that's really an accurate depiction of the state of military readiness today, but some people use that kind of terminology, and trying to perhaps modestly grow the force structure. To do all those three things at the same time with a big, big, ambitious, and wide-ranging modernization agenda does leave one vulnerable to a budgetary cutback or to some other way in which resources won't be adequate for all the tasks at hand. So that's both the way in which it could fall flat and even lead us a little bit astray. The number one worry, of course, is in wartime that we actually have had a concept of operating in a manner that we're not really capable of achieving. So for example, and again, I'm not against the aspiration, but I'm not persuaded we're going to do a good job of dismantling enemy anti-access area control capability or area denial capabilities if we really need to approach right up to the face of a major Russian or Chinese piece of territory, major Russian or Chinese piece of military capability. We may be better in those kind of situations being creative in our asymmetric battle concepts. We may want to take a page out of B.H. Liddell Hart and others who have talked about rather than a frontal assault going around, fighting somewhere else. I'm not going to get into scenarios in this answer, but if we've been persuading ourselves for 5 or 10 years that we figured out the answer to anti-access area denial, but the technology just isn't there to back that up, then our rhetoric could lead us to a war plan that's actually suboptimal and even dangerous to our forces. Again, I'm not suggesting that's going to happen. I'm suggesting that could happen if we take this in the wrong direction.
Thank you. General Sanders, along the challenges side, what are the challenges of the U.S. Adopting MDO from an allies partner's perspective?
I mean, the obvious one is keeping up with you is quite tricky. Always has been. You're very often not interoperable with yourselves, let alone with the rest of us. But that's not a reason not to do it. And I think that because this feels, for all of Michael's really helpful scrutiny and questioning of some of the challenges we face with this, this feels like the right answer to the problem set that we're looking at, or it feels like we're beginning to answer the right questions. So it needs to be done at pace. And I think focusing narrowly, as I said earlier on those who either you have to because of geography, because you're, and I'm thinking of the Pacific and people that you've simply got to work with there, or people who are indispensable in other areas, and allowing allies to contribute where they can in niche domains or niche capabilities in some of those domains is the right thing to do. But I wouldn't go broad front. I would be quite disciplined about the partners that you try and bring with you to begin with. That's challenge number one. I mean, the others are broader. I think, you know, to work this both in the US and also more broadly, seeking agreement on the specific unifying problem, is it Russia, is it China, is going to make life a lot easier. Of course, the truth is that there's more than one problem. I think any new concept and turning it into doctrine is as much about culture as it is about convergence. And particularly joint culture, which feels to be such a critical part of this. I think the orchestration of this at the strategic level and then the military and joint level is really tricky. How do you exercise command and control of this? How do you connect it to, in our case, fusion doctrine with the UK government, in your case, into Washington? And then, of course, there's the urban problem. And I don't think any of us have got a simple answer to that just yet. So those are some of the challenges that we see.
Sir, staying with the challenges, General Brown, what is the biggest challenge we face in the employment and use of MDTF, multi-domain?
Well, thanks. I think it's also the biggest challenge with multi-domain operations, and General Patrick just touched on it a little bit. I worry about joint integration. You know, we all grow up in stovepipes. We think of our own service solution. You know, for many years we did service to service with allies and partners. single service exercises and still do in some cases, and it gets to the culture that he mentioned. In some ways, we would be able to get there without a forcing function. I see we're fortunate in the Indo-Pacific, the combatant commander understands it, Admiral Davidson, and he and Admiral Harris before him, they see it clearly with the challenges that we have in the Indo-Pacific. This is definitely the solution. But, will it be a forcing function that's either a gold, water, nickels, two required or something that forces more joint integration? Or is it a failure that causes this? Or can we do it without that? I think that's a big question. I'd like to think I'm an optimist. I'd like to think we can do it without the failure and without a forcing function. But it is difficult. We'll even see sometimes the senior leaders will understand what needs to be done, but as it's passed down the chain for our folks to start executing it, they kind of go back into that stovepipe and make it a little bit too much of a competition, and that will kill it. And that's related to those cultures that are there, and again, how we're brought up kind of in stovepipes. Now, I do think things we're doing, again, I don't want to be too repetitious, but get out of those stovepipes, like the cross-functional teams, Army Futures Command will definitely work with the other services more, and then what we're doing, and again, with the combatant commander leading the way, every exercise that we're doing, we look at, okay, how do we make a multinational joint, and where are you? We got a combatant commander that's pushing us. How are you integrating in a joint manner? What assets are you using where? How could you do that better? And so that will be extremely helpful and maybe get us there. But I do worry about that. I think that's the biggest challenge for multi-domain operations and multi-domain task force.
I just want to pile onto that, if I could, sir. I think the biggest challenge in employing multi-domain operations in MDOC2, coming up with a means by which you can command and control resources from all domains, which are controlled across services or at varying echelons, will be exceedingly difficult, particularly if we want to get past episodic synchronization. It's got to be continual. So the good news on this front is that there's at least two aspects of strong commonality between the services, and that is we agree on the problem, and we agree that MDOC2 is the biggest challenge that we've got to work through to get it right. Three factors that we consider, and I'm eliciting your support or help on solving this problem, but it's flexible control measures, flexible command relationships, and then we have to have a resilient technical architecture of some sort that allows rapid synchronization of all these domain resources at a decisive space.
Thank you, sir. General Townsend, General Wesley, is the MDO an Army concept or a joint concept?
So, the Air Force and the Marine Corps have been with us arm in arm in the development of this concept from day one, back in 15-16 timeframe. They were part of multi-domain battles development, weren't ready yet to quite sign on to it. We socialized the idea when we were tasked this spring with evolving the concept beyond the multi-domain battle 1.0 version of last fall. We talked to the Air Force and the Marine Corps about, hey, we've been charged by our leadership to make another turn on this document and to do it by the fall. And they said, okay, we're with you. It's going a little fast for us to get signed onto it just yet, but we've agreed to a work plan. And that work plan is, this is an Army concept, but again, it's joint friendly, it's multinational friendly right now. There are no points in there that our sister services object to. The Navy came on board this year, started attending our meetings, conferences, war games, et cetera. The joint staff also attending as well. So I think we're proceeding towards a joint or multi-service concept, and the goal would be to publish multi-domain operations 2.0 a year from now, and it would be signed by at least one other service. If not a fully joint concept, it would be a multi-service concept. But the Air Force and the Marine Corps have been part of this development from day one. Eric, anything else?
I'd just say MDO is a joint effort.
bottom line. It's distinctly joint.
And Bob, I think you might have something to say about your combatant commander out there.
Yeah, and again, it's there's no question you're going to need the leadership. It's got to be joint or it's not going to work. And for us, we have the second Navy Admiral in a row as our biggest proponent because, again, the challenges that you face, you have to do this. I mean, it's very logical, and I agree with Michael, that, you know, the AOC started to lead us to this path and almost right in front of us say, wait a minute now, it's got to be the multi-domain operations is the solution and how you can pull this together. And that combatant commander's emphasis in the joint is key and joint integration, absolutely key.
Thank you, sir. General Townsend and General Wesley, what is the current leading ideas for how organizations will evolve as part of the MDO concept?
Actually, our Secretary of the Army asked us that question quite a lot, and we're there in some ways. We're starting to see the leading edges of how organizations might change, but it's a little early in the development of this concept for us to know how today's organizations will change broadly. But there are some exceptions. So, for example, we have this experimental unit, this pilot unit called the Multi-Domain Task Force, and you've heard General Brown describe its exercise and operations in the Indo-Pacific theater. That has been successful enough that the Army has made a decision to fill out the rest of that organization in the Pacific theater and create another pilot in the European theater of operations. That will begin over this next year. So that's an example of how organizations will change. We're still trying to figure out where that organization best fits in competition or in conflict. General Brown and his team certainly have been informing the Army on that, and he can comment on it if he desires to. We're doing some smaller stuff, like electronic warfare platoons. Forces Command is piloting electronic warfare platoons and our brigade combat teams. Right now, I think John Morrison is at three. Do you know if there's three of these platoons or four of these platoons out there?
There will be a total of six when we're all said and done, and we'll start fielding kit in November.
Okay. So, total of six of these platoons are being piloted. We'll start fielding their equipment. We already have some experimental vehicles out there in the force right now. So, at every echelon, we're examining how does this concept, how does it change the way we fight in the future. Still a little early to know broadly in every organization, but we're already seeing some indications of that, and we're already taking some steps. Eric, and then
yes,
maybe General Brown.
Two things. One is General Townsend mentioned echelons above brigade. One of the things that was the nature of modularity is we divested our capacity to fight as formations at echelons above brigade. So one of the first things we have to do is invest resources, time, energy into being able to campaign at division, corps, and above in order for this to be effective. The second thing is if you threw that modernization framework chart up there again, Andy, that we have. That part of the DOTMAL PF piece of this is the O. And one of the things we say often is we can't FDU our way to 2028.
FDU.
Force Design Update. So we can't. Yeah. Today, we oftentimes change the Army based on a bottom-up effort to make recommendations to formation changes. If we're going to fundamentally change the Army, it's got to be top-down. And so that's the O there. And right now, we're working through a number of organizational changes that the centers have submitted to us, and we'll put together a design. It won't be right, but as we experiment our way forward, we will have at least a pathway to get to that end state.
General Brown, can you comment on where you think maybe MDTF fits?
First, where MDTF, we really thought it would be at about the core level. What we're finding is it's really the combined joint task force level right now. It doesn't mean it might not be valuable at the core field army level, but right now what we're seeing the most is in the theater, a theater asset, combined joint task force level, again, but that doesn't rule out that there might not be others. And I would add on some of the things we're finding, changes that you could see coming. You know, Shorad is one that is already happening, where we had divested of it earlier. Counter UAS capabilities, and of course that goes along with the Shorad, and even innovative things like lasers and that. And then fires, some major changes, strategic, operational, and tactical level of fires. And then even things like hypersonics, potential game changers, and hypervelocity projectiles in those areas. And then certainly in cyber, you're going to have to see some change in where cyber's located. And a lot of us have been talking this for years. You're going to have to be able to do, we have to get after those policies. We have to be able to do more offensive cyber, obviously, potentially forward in a joint operational area, limited, but you've got to get at offensive. If you're going to maneuver in cyber, you're going to lose if you can only do defensive. Defensive is critical, but you're going to have to be able to do some offense. Those are just some of the things that might change formations and things we're seeing early on, but there's many more. So, thanks.
General Townsend, another distinction between the current great power competition and the Cold War is how integrated we are in some of the instruments of power. Our iPhones are assembled in China, for example. How does our level of economic integration with China and Russia affect the military's ability to compete below the threshold of conflict?
I'm glad General Townsend got that one.
Okay. So since I've been called out, I'll take a first crack, and then I'm going to ask for volunteers to my right to help out. Okay. Look, if you went back to that chart, I don't know if they are agile enough to pull up my second chart where I talked about the levels of competition. Basically, it starts at the whole of government there, and you'll see that the adversary is competing with us diplomatically, informationally, and economically. So our economies are intertwined, and short of conflict and competition, we'd like all of our economies to benefit from this interrelationship. Yeah, you can see it there at the top there. But make no mistake, our adversaries are competing with us in that space. And one only has to watch, the news for a day or two to see how our adversaries are competing with us. Now, you know, nations have always competed with one another on the field of economic competition. And that's not necessarily bad. But I think that those nations out there who are near peer adversaries, those nations, their economic motivations are completely intertwined with competition. Where we like to separate, although that's diplomacy, this is economics, that's not part of war. That's not how they see it. This is part of conflict short of armed conflict, competition short of armed conflict. That's how they see it. All that's interrelated. So I think we're going to be challenged. And I said, we're going to have to figure out how to get that game back. And I think during the Cold War, we did compete in the diplomatic space. We did compete in the economic space. We essentially spent our adversaries into bankruptcy. We outspent them, right? So we didn't defeat them militarily on the battlefield. We defeated them on the economic battlefield. We competed with them in the information space. So I definitely think we're going to have to figure out how our nation is going to compete on those playing fields. And I'll ask for anybody to throw me a lifeline. Michael?
Great answer, General. I'm going to give a more specific answer, which is I don't often recommend government reports for your fun reading. But there was a very important report done last week, and one of the worst titles, however, is something like Understanding and Assessing U.S. Defense Industrial Base and Supply Chain Vulnerabilities and Their Resilience Against Enemy Attack. That was the title. And the task force is something like the Independent Task Force in Response to Presidential Executive Order 13608. So they couldn't even get that. But the report is fantastic. And what it does is it goes head on into the question of where have we allowed ourselves to develop specific kinds of weaknesses or vulnerabilities, everything from rare earth metals coming primarily from China, certain kinds of chemicals for propellants and for munitions coming primarily from China. The report painted with a pretty broad brush, and I'm not really convinced that the specialized glass we get from Germany for certain cathode ray tubes is really a national security crisis. But if you read through the report, and there's a classified annex as well to get into specific technologies, it does point the way forward towards taking an eye towards, as you get into actual crisis or conflict, where some of these vulnerabilities could be acute. And it's basically an agenda for trying to mitigate sole source dependency on foreign suppliers. So I think we should take that approach, and sometimes we need to subsidize the certain lower tiers of the defense industrial base, for example, to make sure that we at least have inherent domestic or friendly NATO and close allied capability in some of these key technology areas. The report is very, very good.
Thank you. Okay. General Brown, what gaps do you think we have in the human domain? What does our soldier leader bring to the MDO fight? Have you tested it in the MDTF?
Yeah, well, don't get me started about the human domain. I think, it is, as I said at the end, that's the most important lesson we've learned. Fortunately for us and several of our allies, we have a command and control system, mission command of empowerment. And so we have the ability to empower individuals, and we work it. It's challenging, but I think as we were developing the Army operating concept, we really studied this hard as you look to the future. And we used to say we need leaders who are comfortable in ambiguity and chaos, comfortable. And I think that was good for the time as we're learning. Comfort doesn't win anymore. And if you look in the Army strategy, it sums it up very well, what we determined: trusted teams of professionals that thrive in ambiguity and chaos. It's going to take a team. Trusted teams of professionals, because they're going to be tested like never before, empowered and tested farther forward. You know, the old Private Brown could be on CNN that night. He does something wrong. And then those teams of professionals, because, you know, again, that's the Army is a profession, and anything you do wrong, it's going to, you know, you're going to be exploited greater than ever before in history. Look at the speed of a tweet, the speed of a text that, that we'll talk about those things. So it's the ability to thrive, and that's a different way as you're looking, bringing in, fortunately, as you heard earlier, we're not lowering quality and bringing in soldiers to the Army. We're keeping the quality because they've got to be able to thrive in ambiguity and chaos. And those leaders, developing those leaders, that's why we go back to things like the STE, synthetic training environment, is so key. So those leaders, you can ramp it up, you can ramp it down, you can really push them so they get to where they can thrive. And that what we're finding in the multi-domain task force is exactly that. You know, oftentimes what it takes is old guys like me getting out of the way. They have the commander's intent, and they will figure out how to thrive and do things, connecting things we never dreamed would be connected, or how you'd connect them. And they explain it to me, I still can't figure it out. But you got to get out of the way and empower them, and they'll thrive in that ambiguity and chaos. So most of our good ideas, which is no surprise for all of you, we saw this in combat, the good ideas, surprisingly, don't come from the generals. They come from the cutting edge, those closest to harm. Why? Because their lives depend on it. And it's the exact same way with this multi-domain task force. To make these things happen, we get out of the way, and the closer to the cutting edge those soldiers are, they are thriving. But they've got to be in that learning environment. You know, they can't have an idea and it doesn't work and you shoot them down. It's got to be a learning environment. All the tenets of mission command apply completely. And it is that's why I say the human dimension is the key part. And the good news for us, there are those that would do us harm. You might say, my God, we're giving away all these secrets, and all this stuff. Gosh, why can't they use against us? They can't empower like that. They cannot. They have very tough individuals, some of our near-peer competitors. They're going to do what they're told, but they're not going to be able to do, mission command and implement the commander's intent. They're going to do what they're told and what they're told only. And our leaders and soldiers will do, sailors, airmen, Marine as well. I mean, it's just a joint, no doubt about it. We'll take the initiative and be the difference. So
thank you, sir.
But I'm not passionate about that at all.
last question. General Wesley, General Townsend, as we in industry digest MDO 1.5, what is your feedback mechanisms for industry to back brief you on the capabilities that might help more MDO from concept to doctrine?
Call me. Seriously, and if somebody in the room is trying to find a breakthrough, come see me, because we're looking for this solutions to hard problems all the time. There's two things I would probably answer that. Number one is industry days. ARCIC does industry days. The centers do industry days. And those are venues where we really are letting our hair down in order to hear your feedback. So take advantage of those industry days and hold the center commanders accountable for giving you that venue. The other one, and I'll
pitch for AUSA, General Hamm is recognizing the importance of the annual meeting and the winter meeting. He said, "Golly, why don't we do this more often and in a more focused manner?" And what AUSA does is it gives uniformed personnel an opportunity to talk candidly with industry. And these AUSA hosted roundtables about once a month, but particularly focused on the six modernization priorities. And that gives an opportunity for the niche industry to come with their concerns maybe or ideas sharpened against those that are trying to employ MDO.
Thanks. The only thing I'd add to that at all is that each of our cross-functional teams, the eight that I mentioned that are working on the six modernization priorities, all of them have a very robust engagement with a plan with industry. So I think that's your first inject point is with those CFTs and their leads. Okay, we'll wrap up. That was our last question. Thank you to the audience for showing up. We got a pretty full house here and had great questions from the audience. So I want to thank you for your interest in this topic, for showing up and participating. I also want to thank our panel here today for participating and providing really good thoughts here. Our purpose was to facilitate a discussion about our Army's new warfighting concept, multi-domain operations, and its current evolution. Provide an overview of that concept, provide you with some examples of how we're doing multi-domain operations even today, and how we envision doing them in the future. And then also to provide a few cautionary thoughts coming from us about our own concept. Sometimes we get criticized for not listening to the criticism. And actually, that's why we asked Dr. O'Hanlon to participate in our panel to actually tell us what are the potential pitfalls here, to let all of you know that we're getting informed about that and we're deliberately moving to try to avoid those pitfalls. And I'll just finish with where I started. We are in an era, a new era, of great power competition. And our nation and our Army need to think effectively about how to navigate this era. And multi-domain operations is how our Army plans to navigate this path to and through the future. Thanks for coming today.